Hello, in this video I'm going to show you how you can get the basic particle from Houdini into the Unreal Niagara particle system. So as shown in the intro video, what we will do is we will generate a basic particle in Houdini, like you can see here, a basic setup. And we will convert that point data, the point cache or the point cloud, into our Niagara system. So we will just send points to Unreal Engine. Overall workflow will be that we will have a node to export the point information. This will be saved in a point cache file. And we can open this file in our Niagara system with the plugin, of course. So that's the overall workflow, is we save out all these informations and we can just open that file. So first of all, you need to install the Niagara plugin with Houdini. So you can go here to the tutorials. And there is some options here to download them and also to install them. There's some videos on this as well. And there are more videos here if you're interested in more information on how this is working. Then next up, we also need to install the side effect lab tools. So we can go here to the window menu and we see here a option for side effects labs. So we can click this and here we can either install or update. So I already have them installed. So I can only update them. So here in Houdini, I have a basic particle system. You can get the files from the link in the description. So a quick overrun of the file. So first of all, I'm going to get a model. So in this case, you can, for example, use the pig head or use other dash geometry like here, for example. And then the system will automatically adjust to that particle. So it's a very procedural setup here, so you can plug in custom models. So then we use here a pop network. And in this pop network, what we will do here is we will spawn our particles, and I'm only going to spawn them at the first frame so they don't continually spawn. Then I'm going to add noise here. So I have some noises in the VOP here. And I will, after that, project the particles, because they are very noisy around the area, I will project them back to the geometry. So with the ray nodes, I can project them back here. And also here, it is nice to have a color on them. So I use the velocity.x here to add a color range on them. So you can play around here more, add some nice colors there. So that's the pop network here. So a very basic setup. And also afterwards, I decided to add some scaling, and that would be nice. So I just use the attribute noise, add a pscale value, and then play around here until I have a nice scaling. So to give a little bit preview, I also used here a copy to points. And this is what we get then. So we will get this result. So we get some nice variation there in the scale. And now it is ready for exporting. So we are exporting here the point clouds. So with the Niagara node, which is found in lab. So again, make sure you are installing the lab tools. And just at the top here, we can press render to save out the file. Double check here what range you want to output. So in here, it's the full range that I have here in my timeline. Then we also need to set a specific output. And also here, important as last, you're going to have to double check which attributes we want to save out. So in this case, by default, the pscale value is not here. So we're just going to add here the pscale value that I created from my noise here. And this will also be included in the file. So when you're happy with the settings, just press render and open the file in Unreal. Now here in Unreal, we can import this file, so make sure you are installing the plugin. Then this file is getting recognized. We can open this file and double check some of the information. So we can see here the number of total samples. We can have the attributes, the points, the frames, first frame, last frame, the minimum time, maximum time. This is really useful to know how long my particle actually emits. So we can use this later on in the Niagara system. And here, important is then all the attributes that are being exported and can be used in the Niagara system. Now further, we are going to use this file to then create a Niagara particle. But before, let's double check if everything is ready for this. So we're going to go here to view options, and we're going to make sure we are showing plugin content here. So enable plugin content, and you should be able to see all these files over here. So when you scroll down enough, you will see a folder called Houdini Niagara content. In here, you should be able to see different folders, and we have here a folder with our basic emitters. So we are going to use these emitters so we don't have to start from scratch. So let's create here a Niagara particle. So I'm going to right click Niagara system, and we can, for example, take the first option here, and if everything went right, you should be able to see here the Houdini Niagara basic system. So you can use this if you see this. If you did not see this, let's just start with an empty one. I'm just going to call this base particle, and let's open this. So it's an empty system, and I want to add a particle. So I want to add that Houdini emitter. So in here, if I type in Houdini emitter, I can see this. But again, here, the same as before, we need to actually enable the plugin content. So if this is not enabled, you will never find that Houdini particle. So you're going to have to enable the plugin content. And now when we just type in Houdini, we can see our basic particle here. So we're going to just spawn that in our scene. And by default, it will create this object. So now what I want to do is I want to plug in my own file. So right now it's using a position on surface file, and I want to use my basic particle file. So we have to do this in this case 3 times. So these 3 files need to be replaced by my file. So when that is done, you can see that we already have that big head geometry here, and now it is gone. You can see this is exactly what we had in Houdini. So the reason now why this is gone is if I look at the total duration of my loop, it is 10 seconds. But I know from my file here that my duration is actually 3.3 seconds. So my loop should not be 10 seconds, but just 3.3 seconds. So now we have a looping particle. You can then also here clamp this if you want to. Then further, the lifetime is also set to 10 seconds, which is way too much. You can even set this to 0.1, because every frame there will be new particles spawning. So then we have this result. So as you can see here, by default, we have these nodes that will get the information from our file. It will by default also set the position. So it will do that multiple times. Then here, when I go to update and I click to my parameter folder, we can also add this here if you don't have this open. And we can here double check what Niagara is reading from our Houdini file. So this is all the attributes that we can access now in my Niagara system. So what I would like to do is, for example, use the color attributes, and I want to use the colors to then color, of course, these particles. So I'm going to add a module, type in color, use the default color one, and now I want to add here with this icon my color. So when I type in here color, I can see that the color is not appearing. My Houdini color is not appearing. So I should see particle Houdini color. So I am not seeing that. So the reason that is because the color here is expecting 4 floats. So it's expecting RGB and an alpha value. But my color here is only a type vector. So it only contains 3 floats. So we're going to have to open here the advanced menu. And now we're going to have to fill in here the colors. So now I see Houdini color. And now I have that Houdini color. So it's important to know what type of information you are saving and want to overwrite here in the system. So it has to be consistent in what you're doing. So the other thing that I wanted to do is using my scale value. So everything is now the same scale, but I can go here and set scale. So in this case, if I would type in scale, for example, we see multiple options for the scaling. And what is important to know in this case is what renderer are we using. So I'm just using sprite renderer. So what I want to do is I want to type in just sprite, and I want to use the scale sprite size. So this will give two floats, so an X and a Y, and my scaling is actually just one float. So we will also have the same issue as before. If I would type in P scale, this does not work because we are expecting here two values. So I'm going to just type in here, convert this vector 2 to a float. So we can control now the scale by one single float value. And what we will now do is fill in that P scale. So Houdini P scale. So this might happen actually that nothing is appearing. And that is because there might be a scaling difference in what we had in Houdini compared to what we need to use here in the Niagara system. So what I want here is I want to actually multiply two floats by each other. So I want to multiply two values. So I want to have the scale value, the B scale value. And let's say I want to multiply this by 1,000. Let's see if that makes difference. No, let's go even higher. And now if we go quite high, we can see the difference. The scaling we set in Houdini might be a very small scale, and we need to then upscale this here back to in the Niagara system. You could further even play more with this, and let's say we want, for example, this to be a curve. So you can have even this as a curve here. So I can say that we start from a small particle, we go larger, we add more points, we crank this up again, and instead of normalized h, let's use the loop h, so normalized loop h. Now further, there are some more interesting things we can do. So right now what we have here is we have baked information from a file and loaded into the Niagara system, but we can actually add, for example, a certain velocity. So let's use the vortex force here, for example. Let's place that above the forces. And as you can see, it already starts to move a bit. So if I would crank this up, you can see we are playing around or manipulating the baked information. So if I maybe do minus, we have then this going on. So this can be really interesting to combine baked information with some sort of more real-time changes. So what we can do now is we have our particle, drag and drop this in my scene. And now we have that working here. So just a nice looping here of my particle. So we can still play around here with like the material and so on, and get more variation. So notice also one more thing here with the scale is I set it pretty high, and I actually had to lower it because there is a big difference here when I actually opened it in my scene compared to what I see in my viewport of Niagara. So in here everything looks okay, but I cannot see it here in my viewport. So we're gonna have to play around with that value. So as you can see here, setting this already just to 30, it gives a cool effect, but you can see this is already way too big. That was it for this video. That was the basic workflow of how to get the particles from Houdini into the Niagara system with that point cache file. So I hope you enjoyed the video. Thank you for watching.